The Paragould Mayoral Debate, presented by the Arkansas State University School of Media and Journalism and KAIT. Here is your moderator, Diana Davis.
After more than 20 years, the city of Paragould will elect a new mayor. Mayor Mike Gaskell announced that he will retire this year, and now three men are running to be his successor. Tonight, you'll hear from them as we present the 2020 Paragould Mayoral Debate live from Arkansas State University School of Media and Journalism. And now, those men are Jesse Fry. He is Chief Electrical Inspector for the City of Jonesboro. Josh Agee. He is a current City Council member and owns Agee Distributing in Paragould. Farrell Gibson. A local businessman, he owns Terry's Cafe and Gio's Espresso, and he's a city council member. Now let's begin tonight with opening statements. You'll each get 2 minutes for this, and we randomly drew the order before tonight's broadcast. We begin with Jesse Fry.
Well, I want to thank you for having us here. And my name is Jesse Fry. I'm 38 years old. Grew up in Swifton, Arkansas, graduated in 2001, and I moved to Paragould and instantly fell in love with the city. And over the years, I've took and just had an admiration for the people and everything that's went on. And I became an electrician, got my master's license, and I've been doing that for 16 years. And I'm like she said, I'm now a Chief Electrical Inspector of Jonesboro. I have owned my own business for 5 years, and I'm proud to be standing up here and standing next to these two opponents and see what we can do for the great city of Paragould. Thank you.
Mr. Fry, thank you. Josh Agee.
Thank you, Diana. And I'd like to thank KAIT, KASU, for hosting this debate. I think the fact that we're here on such a large stage just shows how important that this election is to our city. And it would be very remiss of me not to mention that we have prospered under 23 years of leadership from Mayor Mike Gaskell, so I would like to thank him for his service. Also, I'd like to thank my wife and three daughters. Anyone who's ever ran for any sort of elected office realizes that it's a sacrifice for not only the candidate, but for also their family. And I would like to thank my wife and daughters for being there with me every step of the way. 8 years ago, I had the privilege of being elected to Paragould City Council, and I realized very quickly that just showing up to meetings and voting yes and going home wasn't helping our community. So I started getting as involved as I could. I started riding along with our officers, and I'm the only one standing here tonight who has spent any time in the front seat of a police car. I feel like the only way to find out what our men and women in blue, the first responders, what they deal with on a daily basis is to go out there and see it for myself. I wanted to walk a mile in their shoes, and I've continued to do that. And finally, I'm running for our future. I mentioned my three daughters. My oldest just recently relocated to Little Rock to pursue her master's degree, and I want to build a Paragould that she'll come back to. If we want to make Paragould a place that our kids and grandkids come back to after college, or they stay after high school and pursue a career, we must start now. Thank you.
Mr. Agee, thank you. Farrell Gibson.
Thank you, Diana, KASU, KAIT, and Arkansas State University again for having us here, and all the viewers that's tuned in tonight. My name is Farrell Gibson, and I am running for Mayor of Paragould. I'm a lifelong resident of Paragould. I've been married 34 years to my beautiful wife, Kelly Keeter Gibson, and we have four amazing daughters. I'm an active member in our church. I own two small businesses, and I've had the privilege of serving Paragould as a city councilman for 19 years. I graduated from Paragould High School, went on to Arkansas State University to study business administration. When I was 16 years old, I got a job part-time sacking groceries, worked my way through high school, then I worked my way through college. I know how it is to have to work hard to get what you want out of life. I get up every morning at 4 a.m. and I go to work. And I'm gonna take these same work ethics that I have for me today into the mayor's office when I begin in January. I'm ready to step into that spot as mayor day one. With my 19 years experience of local city government, I know how it works. I know the department heads, I know the people and how it runs. I've got 35 plus years of management experience and leadership what I'm bringing to the office when I come. My platform is simple. I want to keep Paragould safe. I want to keep Paragould clean. I want the cost of living low for everyone. I want to work with our senior citizens, and also I want to develop our youth for our future.
Mr. Gibson, thank you. Candidates, thank you. You will each have 1 minute and 45 seconds to answer each question. If you stray off topic, I'll direct you back to that question. And once your time is up, indicated by the timekeeper just off camera, I will ask you to end your answer. We will also have lightning rounds tonight with just 1 minute answers. We'll have more on that when we get to them. Let's begin with our first question tonight. In every community, public safety is always top of mind for people. Paragould has made strides in public safety. There's a new fire station and a centralized dispatch center. If elected, how would you increase public safety and pay for it? And how would the national conversation on police funding play a role in your decisions? Now, we start with Josh Agee.
Thank you, Diane. That's a great question. I think that given today's political climate, that our officers are faced with an ever-changing workforce. That's one of the reasons that I've went out on ride-alongs to see what they deal with. We have to make sure that our officers are given the tools, the training, and the technology to deal with an ever-changing workplace. Right now, the latest census numbers are about to come in, and Paragould is hoping to hit 30,000 residents. We should have 2 officers per every 1,000 people. So that means we should have about 60 officers of 30,000 people. We have 52. We have 4 shifts, so that means we're 2 men short on every shift. My plan from day one is to hire 4 additional officers, and then to incorporate Sky Cops in our high crime and our parks so that we can bridge the gap from being 8 officers short to only 4 officers short, and that's what I'm gonna do day one. There's money in the budget, in the existing budget, to pay for these 4, and that's my plan.
Mr. Agee, thank you. Farrell Gibson.
Thank you, Diana. Public safety is an issue that I also strive for in our city. We do need more police officers. They need more training, and they need our support. My plan is from day one to give them the training they need, to send them out. We have the money. It's in the budget. We can train these officers. We can give them the equipment they need to work on an everyday basis to protect them and to keep them from going, or for them to go home safe themselves to their family at night. There's grant writers out there, and I propose to hire a grant writer. The Department of Justice, you can have several different grants to help get equipment for these officers, even supply police officers. So our need is great for them. I do want to see the city safe. And that's my ultimate goal.
Mr. Gibson, thank you. Jesse Fry.
Thank you very much. And just like Mr. Agee, I've also rode around with state troopers in the past on midnight shifts, and I did see what they go through on a daily basis. I was unaware that Paragould allowed ride-alongs. But the Sky Cop program, I've talked to many of the police officers here in Jonesboro, and it has done miraculous things. And, cut down crime in the places where there were shootings, drugs. And you do put them at the parks because it does save our children. It keeps it better, makes a better quality of life. And so I agree 100% on that. And Farrell's right, a grant writer is definitely needed. I don't want to dip into the funds to start hiring multiple police officers. I've been talking to people in Carriage Hills and other places where they're having problems with people speeding down streets with children. There's a thing called a speed table. It's a table that's designed for the width and the height to be put on that street so that if you're going to correct speed limit, you will actually hit that speed and you will not be affected by it. But if you're speeding, then you will hit it and you will know it. Thank you.
Mr. Fry, thank you. Gentlemen, thank you. Under Mayor Gaskell, Paragould has had a lot of growth in recreation improvement. A voter-approved 2001 sales tax-funded projects like the Aquatic Center, soccer, softball, and baseball fields. But with all of that growth, there are still concerns about young families moving to communities that offer a better quality of life. What specific projects will you pitch to the people to take the city forward and keep those families in Paragould? We start with Farrell Gibson.
Thank you again, Diana. Quality of life is very important. I was on the city council in 2001 when we opened and started Aquatic Center. I believe we opened that in 05 though. And that is a great asset to the city. It's used by the young and by the seniors also. We've worked on several different parks, and all of our parks are all remodeled and renewed. I helped work on the Paragould Youth Softball Association before I joined the city council, and we improved that park. But I would like to see even more things done for the quality of life. I'm working now with some residents for a center for our youth for after-school programs where they can go to, and they can watch movies, they can play putt-putt, but they will have trained people with them to help them to do homework, to guide them in whatever they need to have in their lives. I want to integrate, we used to have a PE in the park that was on the Labor Day park where kids could go after school and play and participate, and one of the parks people was there to do the programs with them. I want to integrate more stuff in the communities. When the kids come home from school, they can go to a special designated area and they can be with people to help them and to guide them and to let people know that we are a safe place, we are a community that we can go to, and we have plenty of things for our youth and for our seniors to do.
Mr. Gibson, thank you. Jesse Fry.
Yes, one of the things that I've strived for since this campaign started is the east side of Paragould. We have a major problem with deterioration of roads, infrastructure, and flooding on a massive level. And where there has been things implemented in the past to get those things done, it's still a problem. Where we can focus going south towards Jonesboro or even west, one thing we got to do is back up and start looking at the places that are ran down, piled with trash, and not attack them with code enforcement, but more or less go in there and help these citizens clean up their neighborhoods, get their quality of life back, get their kids' safety that they can play back in the streets like we did when we were kids. And at the end of the day, the quality of life will come from a massive cleanup. And I've got a plan to do this without costing the taxpayers any more money or sending it to the mayor. So I appreciate it, and thank you.
Mr. Fry, thank you. Josh Agee.
Thank you, Diana. Many of our citizens know that I am an executive member of a local nonprofit, the Green County Future Fund. In 2016, we started and applied for a grant. The first grant we got was for $403,000. In 2018, we applied for another $500,000 grant and were awarded about $395,000. We recently applied for a third and final $500,000 grant. We still haven't gotten word back, but we should soon. This was for the 8 Mile Creek Trail project. It is a 4 mile paved walking path that connects many of our parks, our schools, and our local amenities. I feel like having our kids being able to get out and go from park to park and even have the schools incorporate outdoor classrooms is vital. I think we've seen during this pandemic that virtual learning is something that may be with us for a while. I have pushed over the past 2 years to have Wi-Fi in our city parks. If you look now, it would be nice for our kids who, most of our schools are one-to-one. So in other words, all of our children who are in school right now have a device to take home and learn on. How nice would it be for them to be able to get onto this trail and go from school to park and be able to do their homework and schoolwork? I think connectivity of the trail is going to move our city in a progressive manner. Thank you.
Mr. Agee, thank you. Our program tonight is in partnership with A-State and KASU Public Radio, and KASU News Director Jonathan Reeves has Our next question.
Thanks, Diana. My question is, if you're elected, what would be your goals in the first 100 days in office?
Thank you, Jonathan. And that question goes first to Jesse Fry.
Thank you. The first thing that I would do is immediately start on the east side, and I would do what is called a clean sweep program, where we'd go ward by ward, and every 2 weeks start doing a trash pickup with the citizens' help. They come out, they bring all the stuff of their yards to the front, and the city will work with them to get rid of that trash at no charge on a one-time deal. That right there will be a massive cleanup of Paragould. And then I want to start getting bids, open bids, that will be for road and infrastructure repair, because I even hit the massive potholes that are all around town that have been neglected all over the east side. And as mayor, that is a priority, is trash cleanup, quality of life on the left side, and actually moving forward, because you're not going to move forward in the city unless you take care of every bit of it. Thank you.
Mr. Fry, thank you. Josh Agee.
Thank you, Dinah. I have five things that I would like to accomplish in the first 100 days. Number one, I would like to start the redistricting and the updating of our zoning map. Our current zoning map is a few years out of date, and with the opening of the bypass Friday, it's going to change the layout of the way the streets are in our city, so that zoning map has to be brought up to date. Also, we've never had a pedestrian walking plan. Right now, our streets and our sidewalks don't coincide, and we have sidewalks that don't mesh together. That has got to be fixed. We have kids that are ending up walking in the middle of our streets just to get to school. I want to hire those four officers that I talked about and improve safety. I want to hire, day one, I want to hire an additional code enforcement officer. Our code enforcement officer is so overworked that he can't keep up with the call volume. So I want to double down on that so that we can expedite the cleanup. I feel like economic development is tied directly to code enforcement and public safety. So that will help push the economic situation in our town. And then finally, I want to have a city app, and I want to put our budget on there. I was recently visiting with a lady who said she ran a $1 million construction company, and she couldn't understand our budget. So I told her, I said, I'm going to make sure that the budget is transparent, that it's easy to read, and that you can get on our city app, and you can pay fines, and at any time you can look on there and see anything that's being taken out of our budget or put back into. Transparency is key.
Mr. Agee, thank you. Farrell Gibson.
Thank you, Diana. Again, I want to stress on public safety. I want to back our first responders and give them the personnel, the training, and equipment they need to keep the citizens safe and themselves safe. I'd also want to hire a grant writer to work on programs for different parts of our city so they can go in and we can use grant money that's paid for by other communities, like an 80-20 match where 80% of the money is paid by other people and we only pay 20. I would like to start programs with our youth, which I've already been talking to some people about. So if they're not wanting to go on to a four-year college, they can look at a vocational school. I've got people that wants to take them out on the job sites and show them what it's like to be a boss for themselves, to be an electrician, a welder, or whatever they want to be, and show them what the benefits are and show them how they can obtain that by vocational degree. I also want to keep the cost of living low down for everyone, and a grant writer will also help prepare this, keeping the cost low and not using all the taxpayers' dollars for different projects around town. Thank you.
Mr. Gibson, thank you. In so many elections, you hear candidates talk about transparency. So this next question is about that. How do you define transparency in government operations, and how would your office be more transparent to voters? We begin with Josh Agee.
Well, just like I said, I was visiting with the girl, and she's actually running for council, and she called and she said, I don't understand this budget. And I said, well, first off, you have to understand that municipal budgets are, there are rules and regulations that stipulate how money can be spent. So I went down and I spent about an hour with her explaining it. And I told her, I said, one thing that we're going to do is we have to realize that we are spending taxpayer money. We have to be good stewards. The city of Paragould is blessed with some really nice reserves, a rainy day fund. We have to make sure that those are protected. But at the same time, I want to make sure that the citizens know where their money is going. This is my tax money and your tax money. So you're going to be able to get on our website, click on the budget, and you can see where money's coming in and where money's going out. Also, I spoke with Teresa, our financial director, yesterday, and I told her that day one, I want to make videos, and I want to put them on our website so that John Public can get on there and watch those videos and understand the budget, understand the laws that keep street money on one side, general money on the other, Act 988 money in a separate, Linwood Cemetery is different. We have all these different facets of the budget that have to be kind of explained, and I want to do that from day one. That way, that John Public and the citizens of Paragould know where their money's going and feel safe knowing that we're good stewards of their money.
All right, Mr. Agee, thank you. Farrell Gibson.
Thanks again, Diana. Yes, I want to make the city of Paragould more transparent. Right now, even our city council members, you can see it on our city cable channels, but you can't live stream it through Facebook. And a lot of our citizens today use Facebook and other types of media devices to watch and learn about what is going on with the city. I would like to create the Facebook page. I would like to stream our meetings on Monday nights so that the people can be aware. I want to make it more transparent too and show how the code enforcement works. A lot of people don't realize the steps you have to go through when you're going to condemn a house or you're just even going to go try to get them to mow a lawn. It's not just a simple knock on the door. It's a process. So I want that to be more transparent because once people understand the process that we have to go through in everyday basis, they will understand why it's not getting done instantly, and they'll know what's going on with that. Also, I just want to be transparent with our police department. I would like to have a meeting like once a month or once a quarter where an officer or two will come out and have like a public meeting with them and let them know what's going on in the city and what's going on with the police department in the hot areas, and let them ask questions. So it's a question and answer thing, being more transparent to our city.
Mr. Gibson, thank you. Jesse Fry.
Yes, I think it is a wonderful idea to have a website and Facebook and to be transparent, have an open door policy to the office for everybody that has a concern in the city of Paragould can come up and see the mayor and actually ask and find out what's going on. So, you know, I've looked at quite a few things, and I can see why transparency is so big now. Over the past 5 years, over $8 million has went out on no-bid contracts. If those would have been bidded, it would have saved the taxpayers tons of money that could have went for road repair, could have went for infrastructure and multiple things. So I guess my question is, in 18 years and 8 years, why are we just now talking about transparency? But I will have a very open, transparent, where you can know everything about me as mayor. Thank you.
Mr. Fry, thank you. Gentlemen, thank you. We are going to take a break. When we return, we'll discuss jobs, trash, and downtown.
Ah, the census, my favorite time of the decade.
Census, what's that?
Oh, it is a special time when we count each person in every home in all the neighborhoods across the country. One monster of Sesame Street.
Oh, do kids count?
Of course. Everyone in your home counts, especially little kids and babies. One, two. Two little kids.
But why do we count everyone?
Ah, great question. Counting everyone in your home helps support your neighborhood for the next 10 years by funding things like schools, hospitals, and buses. So count yourself and everyone in your home. In 10 minutes, you can complete the census by calling or going online, or return your form by mail.
It's easy, secure, and most important, it's totally private.
Make your family count!
Ah, ah, ah!
This year, make sure every child counts. Visit 2020census.gov.
I came out in the 11th grade. Nobody was embracing you. The kids were cruel. It was very difficult to be gay. Not completing high school is more of a social thing than it was an academic thing. And even though all these years have passed, I still had that longing to have my diploma. I have a mentor, Maria, and she convinced me to continue my education. Just never judges. She's a true role model.
From the depths of my heart, I thank you, Maria, for being a friend and a beautiful person. No one receives a diploma alone, and I'm honored to share this moment with you. Thank you.
If you're even considering getting your high school diploma, go get it. You can do it.
Find free adult education classes near you at finishyourdiploma.org.
And best friends.
I love my sister.
My heart doesn't see race. Love is love.
Our family is no less than any other family.
Love is kind. Love is
Welcome back to the Paragould Mayoral Debate. We're broadcasting tonight live from A-State, the School of Media and Journalism. Let's turn now to Amanda Hansen. She's live at the Region 8 News Digital Desk with a question from many of you at home. Amanda.
Diana, I've been monitoring the Facebook live stream on the Region 8 Facebook page. There's been a lot of conversation about party affiliation. Municipal races in Paragould are nonpartisan, but in recent months, the candidates for mayor have chosen a party affiliation to run under. So how are you going to run the city if elected in a nonpartisan way?
I am so sorry. We could not hear Amanda Hansen here in the studio. So we might have to go back to Amanda just a little bit later because I couldn't hear her as well, so I know that we couldn't hear in the studio. So let's right now take the next question from KASU News Director Jonathan Reeves. Jonathan.
Diana, thank you. My question is, if you're elected mayor, what kinds of business and industry would you be interested in bringing to Paragould?
All right, thank you, Jonathan, for that question. And we start that question with Jesse Fry.
I believe one of the biggest things that we really need to bring to Paragould is an entertainment for our children to be able to go to. You know, the bowling alley shutting down many years ago. We used to have an arcade a long time ago. I would like to see a more family-oriented place so people have a good place to go where the kids are safe, good food. As of industrial, I would love to get more companies in there. That way it also brings the wages up and makes other factories compete for wages and try to bring up so everybody brings home a little more in paycheck. But at the end of the day, I think really the biggest thing is I want more family-oriented stuff. That way we all have something to do. Instead of coming to Jonesboro for everything, I think some shopping centers, put more clothes out there, and the makeup and everything for the women. But I think it's more of a family thing. I think that we need to get back to our grassroots of Paragould and really bring back the family-oriented and go with that. Thank you.
Mr. Fry, thank you. Josh Agee.
Thank you, Diana. I think one of the biggest things that we have to remember when it comes to economic development that is 80% of our citizens are employed by just 20 businesses. So we have to make sure that those 20 employers are taken care of. First and foremost, we have to protect what we already have. Second off, I believe that tomorrow's workforce is going to be able to work from home. I speak to many industry leaders across all the various aspects of industry in Paragould. And one of the biggest hurdles that they have to face is recruitment of young professionals. I feel like that's where the quality of life initiatives tie in directly, because when we're trying to recruit these young professionals, these mid-30s with families, high-paying jobs, they want to pick a community where there are quality of life initiatives, where it's family-friendly. We have to start now pushing that forward. And then third and finally, I think I have a unique perspective. I'm on the Innovation Committee for the Economic Development Corporation in Paragould. It's something that's a separate from the city, but I was asked to be a part of it, and it's given me great insight to how economic development works in the city. One of the latest projects we took on was a solar project that keeps the cost of our utilities low and it keeps the cost of living low, and that's always business friendly.
Mr. AG, thank you. Farrell Gibson.
Yes, Diana, there's no certain industry or recreational or business that I want to bring in. I want to bring in anybody that's wanting to come. I'm willing to work with our chamber director. We just have a new one this year. Allison Heston's going to do a great job. I'm willing to go with her wherever we need to go and help recruit industries or business to come in to downtown. Again, I would like to see more vocational training done to our youth to keep the professionals in town, as far as the electricians, the plumbers, the building contractors, and teach them and show them how to strive and have more of them businesses in town led by our citizens and our youth to keep them home, to let them know that they got a hometown that they can stay in and work and make good money. I would like to see more recreational come into town so that we could have entertainment on the weekends. We could do more with our families. I would also like to keep and see just businesses come in, from clothing stores to restaurants to just any jewelry stores, to come in, to especially our downtown area. It's such a great place to visit and a great place to be. So I would welcome any business and help EDC and the Chamber of Commerce to bring these businesses in.
Mr. Gibson, thank you. Let's do some trash talking. Not political mudslinging, but instead literal trash. It's been a very big topic recently, especially large waste material disposal. If you're elected, how do you plan to clean up the city and make sure it doesn't get trashy in the future? Let's start with Josh Agee.
I think one of the issues that we're seeing right now is the process is so burdensome. Right now, if I was just knocking doors and I was in the Stafford edition, and I ran across a friend of mine who is a CASA volunteer, and he had a couch and a love seat in his front yard, and I said, "Jeremy, what's the deal with this?" And he said, "I've been trying for 3 weeks to get them to pick this up, but you have to go out there, and you have to make a phone call. They have to drive by and see how much it's going to cost. Then they call you and let you know. And then you go to City Hall and you pay your fee, you get a receipt, you have to take it to the city barn, and then they'll put you on the list. All this should be done with technology. You should be able to take a picture with your phone, send it in, and expedite that process. Also, we should be able to take fees. The app that I talked about earlier, where the budget will be, there'll also be a place on there that we can pay fees, whether that be plumbing fees, HVAC, if you need a building permit, if you want to pay to get large item picked up. It needs to be done. We need to be able to expedite the process and help clean up our streets.
Mr. Agee, thank you. Farrell Gibson.
Trash is a big issue, and it is one of my number one issues. The city council and the mayor has been working on trash issues now for several years. It wasn't too many years ago where we just put trash bags out on the curb, and a men would come by and collect the bags and throw them in the back of the truck. We bought over 10,000 trash cans and gave to the citizens of Paragould, and then bought an armed truck to help make the city look better so trash bags wouldn't be sitting. And it cut the cost of pickup down even two, since there's only one man operating the truck. And yes, large trash items are a problem in Paragould because of the process. Like Mr. AG says, they have to come out, assess it, then you have to pay it, then they'll come and pick it up. When I take over as mayor, a garbage truck will go down the street at least once a week or four times a week. I want that truck to be able to pick the item up right then without having to call in, without going through the hassle, and then we can send a bill out to that address to whoever's paying the light bill or the water bill, because sometimes they are rental properties. Instead of sending it to the renter, we want to send it to the people who's setting out there. But I want the large item pickup to be faster, more efficient, and more affordable for everyone in the city to get these items cleaned. And this Saturday, my team, theirself, is going to go out on the street starting at 9 o'clock, and we're going to start cleaning up Paragould. We're not going to wait till the first of the year. We're starting now. Thank you.
Mr. Gibson, thank you. Jesse Fry.
Thank you. You know, I've went and I've driven many of the east side roads in Ward 4 and even a lot of Ward 2. And it's an amazing amount of couches, love seats, mattresses and everything that are just piled up everywhere. This is something that should have been taken care of a long time ago. This is one of the reasons I've decided to run, was because there are ways to get this picked up and help the citizens. What I want to do is a one-time waived fee where you bring everything to the front, and we're going to have our claws, our trucks with our big claws, come by and actually grab the big stuff and take that to the city landfill. And then we're going to turn around and bring trucks with the trailers and any small things. The residents can actually help load that into those trailers as help and payment. And then after that is all cleaned up and all spotless, then the next time that you got to have something hauled off, it can either be put onto a Paragould Sea Light and Water bill, or you call it in and go pay for it. But I believe that we can help the citizens without burdening them with more taxpayer and buying more and more devices to keep up with the trash. We just got to help our citizens first. Thank you.
Mr. Fry, thank you. Our next question, downtown Paragould has seen quite a bit of growth over the past decade. Many empty storefronts now house thriving businesses. There was even talk of an entertainment district allowing for drinks to be taken outside businesses in a certain area. That proposal didn't make progress with the city council. So, as mayor, would you support that entertainment district? And what other projects would you like to see in downtown Paragould? We start our questioning with Farrell Gibson.
Thank you, Diana. Yes, this is a hot topic for the citizens of Paragould. I was sitting on a committee when the entertainment district came up. It never made it out of committee. On that, let me explain what an entertainment district is just briefly. It limits an area to downtown where if you're in a restaurant or a place that serves alcohol, when you finish eating and you want to take your drink with you and go out, you can put it in a specific cup or container and go out into the street and go down to the park or whatever activity is going on with your drink and be part of it. I am for entertainment downtown. Right now we have festivals where we close the streets on the weekends. I love stuff like that. We have many things going on, car shows, bike shows. We have art and stroll. I'm behind that 100%. But far as every week being able to take an open container out on the street, I am not for open container drinkings on the streets every week, because this is going to bring in, you're going to have to get more police down to monitor the area when you're taking out the drinks on the street. You're going to have to monitor if they're getting it out of their car instead of just a restaurant. And then you're also going to have to monitor if they're properly exposing their cups and everything. So I know a lot of times after events go on, there's a large item trash pickup that you have to do because of stuff left. Thank you.
Mr. Gibson, thank you. Jesse Fry.
Thank you very much. You know, downtown Paragould, and I was questioned about this not too long ago, but I think they have done a good job of refurbishing the buildings and making it look presentable. You know, it'd be nice if maybe the business owners that own those businesses and the shops maybe give incentives to people to come in and maybe drop the cost of rent for a year to let them get established. But one of the biggest things is I would love to have an entertainment area where there is a consistent, if not every weekend, deal. But I am absolutely against bringing alcohol outside so that minors can get a hold of it or anybody. And it will cause a trash pileup, and it will cause a more police presence. And overall, you're asking for trouble. Where I agree, the entertainment is awesome. The car shows, I love cars, George Ray's Drag Strip. We get out there, have car shows, motorcycles coming in, art shows. But at the end of the day, no alcohol, because it's not worth the cost of everything added to it. Thank you.
Mr. Fry, thank you. Josh Agee.
Thank you for asking. I'm glad this got brought up. Downtown is very special to me. My wife and I have bought and rehabilitated about 12 buildings downtown. We have decided to put our money where our mouth is when it comes to downtown and making sure that it remains vital. I believe that downtown is our inheritance. It's what the founders of our city built for us, and they left it for us. And if we don't take care of it, we're like the prodigal son. You know, we're the ones who wasted what was given to us. And there's no better definition of local business than going downtown and seeing the shops. Those people that run those shops are people that we know and that we love, the ones that we go to church with and that we commune with. Downtown is where we have festivals such as Art and Stroll, the Get Downtown Festival, and the historic Collins Theater. It's our gathering place. A fact that most people don't know is my wife and I have, in one of those buildings, we renovated the upstairs, and we're raising our two youngest daughters on Pruitt Street. My 9 and 14-year-old daughters' bedrooms have doors that walk out onto balconies that look over Pruitt Street. So at no time would I be okay with making downtown a bunch of bars or another Bill Street. I am for economic development downtown. I feel like it is vital to any innovative community, but it has to be in a family-friendly atmosphere.
All right, Mr. Agee, thank you so much. Our next question is our lightning question, so you'll get 1 minute to answer, and it also deals with alcohol. Ward 4 does not allow alcohol sales. It's been that way since 1998 when voters made that decision. Ward 4 is from Carroll Road to the city's west side city limits. So, should Paragould as a whole be wet or dry, and why? And in this question, we start with Mr. Gibson since he is the sitting council member for Ward 4. So, Mr. Gibson, we'll start with you.
Well, thank you, Diana. I believe that Ward 4 should stay dry. Right now in Ward 4, we have a private high school called Carleage Ridge Academy. We have the children's home, which is a part of Carleage Ridge Academy, and we have Carleage Ridge College. We have Tech Middle School, and I believe Tech Primary also in that area, and several churches. People worked hard in 1998 and had the people vote for to keep in Ward 4 dry. So I would like to keep it dry for the history of the Paragould, for the schools, for the churches. There's plenty of place to go and to buy your alcohol if you want it. A lot of people buy and live in Ward 4 because it's a non-alcoholic ward.
Mr. Gibson, thank you. Josh Agee.
I agree with Mr. Gibson. I've been a lifelong member of Center Hill Church of Christ, and our pastor at the time was Michael Cox, and he was instrumental in making sure to go out, and he beat the bushes, he knocked doors, he went and spoke to every civic organization in town and expressed his interest and his passion in making sure that Ward 4 stayed dry. Like Mr. Gibson said, there are multiple churches and schools, and there are plenty of places to buy alcohol in Paragould as it is, so there's no need in pushing Ward 4 wet.
Mr. AG, thank you. Jesse Fry.
Thank you. You know, the way I see this is the people of Ward 4 are the ones who live there. And honestly, I believe that they should have the voice in this. As mayor, if I stand there and me and the council make it where it's dry, but yet the people have to drive across town and they want it wet, then they should have that ability to do a vote or a poll on something to make sure that that's what they want. I understand the facts of the churches and definitely with the kids, but at the same time, if people's going to buy alcohol, they're still going to buy it across town, so you're still going to have the alcohol there. So if you can bring an extra business down there, that's just more revenue for that area of town and another storefront. Thank you.
Mr. Fry, thank you. Our next question is the one that Amanda posed earlier, but we could not hear it. So, municipal races in Paragould are nonpartisan, but in recent months, candidates for mayor have chosen a party affiliation to run under. How are you going to run the city in a nonpartisan way? We start with Jesse Fry.
Thank you very much. This is a very good question. I've actually talked to many people about this because in today's society, unfortunately, socially, Democrats and Republicans have different viewpoints. I am a proud lifetime conservative Republican. And so at the end of the day, when I have to put an I on the ballot, when I feel like my right, I should be able to put an R beside my name because I'm proud to be a Republican. If somebody else doesn't want to be proud of who they are, they can put an independent. But as mayor, I think that it should be reversed. That way, each individual person in the city of Paragould would be able to see exactly who they're voting for, what party affiliation, because where, as mayor, you don't want to push an agenda. If you're a Democrat, you're going to push Democratic agendas. If you're a Republican, you're going to push Republican ideas and policies. So I believe that it should be partisan. That way, everybody can see.
Mr. Fry, thank you. Josh Agee.
I'm glad Mr. Fry said that if you're a Republican, you push Republican ideas, and that if you're a Democrat, you push Democratic ideas. That is the whole premise behind us going to nonpartisan. Because as mayor, I'm going to represent everyone. I don't care if you're a Democrat, if you're a Republican, or if you're somewhere in the middle. If you are the person like me who votes for the best person who's suited for the job. You know, the issues that we deal with, code enforcement, growing our community, picking up the trash, making sure that we have good hot water and pressure and low cost of living and low utility rates, good police force and clean parks. Those things are not partisan issues. That's why 90% of the cities across the United States are nonpartisan, and that's why we should stay that way.
Mr. AG, thank you. Farrell Gibson.
Thank you, Diana. And again, I agree with, when I wake up in the morning and I put on my mayor's shoes and go to work, I'm representing everybody. It don't matter what party you voted for. It don't matter if you voted Democrat, Republican. You're part of our community. You're a citizen of Paragould, and I'm taking this job to work for you. I'm going to do my best for what you want. In a local election, we don't make a lot of party decisions. That's done more at a federal level. Yes, I have come out that I have joined the Republican Party. I'm a member of the committee. But I want people to know how I line up on a federal level. On a local level, you're my neighbor. I'm going to go to school with you. I'm going to go to work with you each day. I'm going to sell you food when you come downtown. You're my friend, Democrat, Republican, whatever you are, whatever race you are. God made us all equal, and that's how I'm going to stand, and that's how I'm going to serve Paragould, is we're all equal. And we're all in it together, and we're all in for the betterment of Paragould. Thank you.
Mr. Gibson, thank you. It's time for, along with the Eastern Bypass, have been a big transportation project for years. What other transportation projects would you?
For the Delta Asphalt, and we're going to get them roads fixed. There is some roads that I would like to see widened in town. Out by the country club, there's a big ditch on the side. I would like to try to get that fixed so that the safety of the citizen Paragould would be more involved. So there is some areas of transportation that I would like to work on and a lot of roads that I would like to see fixed.
Mr. Gibson, thank you. Josh Agee.
Thank you. I think an overall plan for our city right now would be helpful. I think that right now we're driving around with that pothole patcher truck and just fixing holes here and there. One of the things, like Mr. Gibson said, was Carroll Road is one of those areas that needs to be worked on. Also, with Amendment 1, if it passes, I would like to see the road extended all the way to Marmaduke. I think that there are many, many citizens from Paragould who commute to Marmaduke every day, and we share that road with, or we share that road, and we share some factories with Marmaduke, and I think that would be a great thing to do is to get that done.
Mr. Agee, thank you. Jesse Fry.
Thank you. I can agree, especially that two lane because of so many deaths that's happened between here and Marmaduke. But at the same time, you can mention Carroll Road and you can mention other roads over there. But the one thing that's not been mentioned is any of the east side. The east side of Paragould, under the 8 and 18 years that y'all have been in there, has been neglected. And there is no patches being put in because I have been driving this repeatedly. So the first thing that really needs to be brought is somebody to come in and take open bids to get every one of our streets fixed before we start any new additions anywhere. Thank you.
Mr. Fry, thank you. And those are our questions tonight. We will now have our closing statements, and we'll go in reverse order from the opening statements. So that means Farrell Gibson kicks it off.
Thank you, Diana. And again, thank you, KASU, K8, and Arkansas State University. I'm running for mayor because I'm passionate about our city. I want to see us strive into the future. I love Paragould. I was born and raised Paragould. I raised my children in Paragould. As mayor, when I hit the floor every morning, I want to remember the elderly, such as my mom and dad. I want to remember the working class, like me and my wife. I want to think about the families that's just starting with their kids each day, like my daughters and their families. I want to see the youth be developed, my two daughters still at home. So on November the 3rd, we're going to elect a mayor for the first time in 23 years. So I'm asking you tonight to please vote for me, Farrell Gibson, your next mayor of Paragould, because I will be there for you and I will work hard for you. Thank you.
Mr. Gibson, thank you. Josh Agee.
You know, just this morning I was speaking with a friend of mine, Rodney, and he just had a new grandbaby. And he said, "Why are you running, Josh?" And I said, "Well, because I want that grandbaby to grow up and decide to stay here in Paragould. For the past 10 years, I want the citizens of Paragould to know that there has not been one opportunity that I have passed up to be a better mayor. I have put in a decade of classes, of going out and training. I've spent time with the mayor, with our officers. I have done everything in my power to work hard to be the best mayor that I can be. And in the future, if you'll vote for me, we're going to work together to make Paragould better together. Thank you.
Mr. Agee, thank you. Jesse Fry.
Thanks for having me. You know, I'm not a politician. I'm a businessman. I've dealt with hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of budgets, and I've never failed one. The reason I became and started running for mayor is I seen the decline in our city, and I see many years of incumbents that have not done anything to up and fix those problems. So, you know, basically, to have new change in Paragould, to fix the problems, you got to have new leadership. I'm not asking for 8 years. I'm not asking for 18. I'm asking for 2 years to show you what can actually be done when you put your foot forth and get it done. So if you'll vote for me November 3rd, I would appreciate it, and have a good night, and God bless.
Mr. Fry, thank you. And that is our time tonight. Farrell Gibson, Josh Agee, Jesse Fry, thank you so much for joining us this evening. We will post this entire debate online at KAIT8.com, the Region 8 News app, and across our numerous streaming platforms, Roku, Amazon Fire, and Apple TV. Tonight's debate will be updated there later tonight. And we want to remind you, election night is November 3rd. Early voting starts October 19th. Have a good evening, everyone.